So delighted to be here. Once again, it's Arif Neki. I'm the advisor for strategic partnerships in the UN system in Kenya. We have 21 UN agencies in Kenya, so we have one of the largest global footprints of the UN, including two global head offices, UN Environment and UN Habitat. The global head offices are actually in Nairobi. So we have quite a rich array of institutions here. And we have a number of regional offices that take care of the whole of Africa. So it's an exciting opportunity for us to really look at how we can get behind the vision of the government, and particularly behind the Big Four agenda. What I'd like to just start with is context. One very important issue to think about is in the 50s and 60s, when we sort of neared independence and got independence, there were a number of countries like Malaysia, Indonesia, Singapore, whose economies were quite similar to the economy of Kenya. And we all started with fairly low populations as well. Today, these are all the Asian tigers. They seem to have done extremely well if you look at the per capita GDP or income of citizens in these countries. They've become extremely wealthy countries. And so how did they do that? And what do we need to do now to really accelerate our own economic development? And so if you look at the average age of people in Kenya, we're looking at about 19. In fact, across Africa, I understand it's about 19. If you look at the average age in Europe, it's about 52. That is very important for us to understand, because we have what's called the opportunity of a demographic dividend. It means we have young people who can be absorbed into the economy, into the workforce, who can be productive employees or productive employers and entrepreneurs, who can really grow the economy. And that's what the Asian Tigers did. They made sure they got skilled labor in the knowledge, service industry, manufacturing, into the economy quickly. And we need to get rich before we get old. We've got 30 or 40 years. So it's what I call a receding window of opportunity. Because as you get older, you now have a population, as in Europe, where you have old age pensioners, and a large chunk of old age pensioners with fewer younger people who have to work really hard to support and maintain these safety nets for old people. So the opportunity for us is to get rich before we get old. And the opportunity is now. And I think you are the engine of that potential opportunity. So it's important to have that context and also sense of urgency on why the Big Four is so important. The second context is, of course, around the SDGs. And thanks for the segue to SDGs. So in the year 2000, there was the first global agreement across over 190 countries, member states of the United Nations, which is owned by member states, on what was called the Millennium Development Goals. These were 8 goals around some level of common consensus of where do we want to get in health, in education, in water and sanitation, common problems across the world. So there were targets and goals that were agreed upon. And in 2015, when this was reviewed, there was almost a 2-year process. And Kenya actually took some significant leadership here, because we had Ambassador Macharia come out from Kenya, who was the representative of Kenya to the UN General Assembly, who co-chaired a committee called the Open Working Group to actually develop the SDGs. So the SDGs are 17 goals that have been developed. The interconnected goals, it's about health, education, the environment. It's really about protecting humanity and protecting the planet. And the 17th goal is the one that I'm particularly passionate about, which is around partnerships. Because nothing happens if you work in silos. It's like the African proverb, that if you want to walk fast, you walk alone. But if you want to walk further, you walk together. So we need partnerships in every way. And these 17 goals were adopted in September 2015. And we're looking at a period of 15 years. By 2030, there are clear targets we want to achieve. 17 goals, 169 targets, and over 200 indicators. So it's not just theoretical, abstract, conceptual. It's about concrete targets that are measured, We have over 200 indicators. Now the Kenya government has already selected out of that 150 indicators to start with. The opportunity for me also is, if you look at our society, we often operate in silos. So you talk about private sector, you talk about private sector companies. They have a certain language and a certain etiquette between themselves. They talk about return on investment, IRR, triple bottom line, shareholder value, etc., etc. We speak to the NGOs and we talk about growth frame, outputs, outcomes, indicators, you heard all of that. And yet, when you look at CSR, when you look at social enterprises, the divide between private and non-profits is coming very close. What the SDGs do is cut across the silos and help us all understand the impacts we are making to society in a measurable way. And every year, Kenya creates a report that goes back to the UN to show progress against these targets. The big point I want to also make is that two learnings came out of the MDG process. One learning was that it can't be a top-down process. You know, you can't really get people to do things if they don't own those things themselves. So we need to have a consultative process. And Ban Ki-moon, the last Secretary General, announced the SDG adoption as the most consultative process in history. It was an over 2-year process. The SDGs are therefore not a UN product. It's not owned by government, it's not owned by NGOs. Everybody owns SDGs. We all own SDGs. The government has a mandate to track and report its strengthening. The UN has a mandate to provide technical assistance, but we all own the SDGs. So I would encourage you to get onto Google, to really look at the SDGs, understand the targets, understand the impact measurement framework. And the exciting thing is private sector has jumped onto this as well. So if you look at the Safaricom Sustainability Report, if you look at the Standard Chartered Africa Sustainability Report, they've got SDGs all over them now. We're now talking the same language. It's not like those old CSR reports with so many hospitals and so many schools that you really didn't understand the impact. We now have clear measured impact. The next thing I just want to mention is that if you want to make partnerships work, you really need to make sure that there's ways to break those silos between faith-based groups, NGOs, private sector, government, bilaterals, multilaterals. So what we did was we worked with the government, and the government announced last September in the UN General Assembly the creation of an SDG partnership platform. And in your folders, you'll see some description around the platform. And the platform is really around contributing and complementing the efforts of government to drive the Big Four agenda. So as you're trying to drive the Big Four agenda, there's a lot of public financing that goes towards the Big Four agenda. But we know that in Kenya we have a fairly high debt. And so a lot of our annual funds are spent on repaying those loans. And we also have a high recurrent budget, salaries particularly. So the flexible development financing is fairly finite. We really need to look at other ways to complement development financing. And so the role of the platform is to unlock private and philanthropic capital to support the government in the Big Four agenda. So what does that mean? That means we've created a one-stop center to fast-track investments in Kenya, to make Kenya the most attractive investment destination we can, to improve the ease of doing business. So we now have private sector partners, Philips, Huawei, Safaricom, Merck, AstraZeneca. We have a number of private sector partners. We have bilaterals like the Netherlands and US and others. We have the World Bank and others. And what we do is we go county by county, block by block, and try and understand all the Big Four agenda, starting with health, where the key gaps are, particularly in primary health care, where there's over 30% of Kenyans below the poverty line. And try and understand where the transformative actions might be. And then try and look at those actions and tease out those actions that are what I would call bankable propositions. Which are the actions that can actually have an income stream? Which are the projects that can create income while it's doing good? And which are the ones that we can attract private capital into? Because private capital will come in for a return. And it's important to think about breaking through or disrupting current systems and current approaches. So don't beat them back. It's like this saying by George Bernard Shaw, that, you know, some people look at the world and the state of the world and say, you know, why? And other people dream about a much better world and say, why not? So think about why not. Think about being a disruptor. Don't be held back by my previous paradigms. The other thing I would also say is, this is a saying from the Aga Khan, life is a lofty and noble calling. Life is a lofty and noble calling. It is not a mean and groveling thing to be shuffled through as best as we can. So you're here for a higher calling. And to get to that higher calling, the education, the training, the ICT training, the skills training that you're getting is only as good as its service back to society in Kenya. If you can get the best education and serve society in Kenya, that will be your greatest impact for education. If you don't do that and you simply get certificates and credentials and degrees, it's called intellectual vanity. You're just doing it for yourself. But if you can serve society on an ongoing basis, through your lifelong learning, that is a lofty and noble calling. And I'm delighted that with this group, we have, I think, champions who can move